Good morning, sisters and brothers. So thankful that you're able to join us this morning for the 16th Sunday after Pentecost. You're invited to follow along using the prompts on the screen or using the bulletin found on our website. Together, we give thanks to God as we join in worship this morning. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Let us pray. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Most merciful God, we confess that we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for us, and for his sake forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ, and by his authority, I forgive you all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Together, we sing our opening hymn.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not thy compassions, they fail not. To me.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all, and also with you.
Lord have mercy,
Lord have mercy,
Christ have mercy,
Christ have mercy,
Lord have mercy. In peace we pray to the Lord. Lord have mercy,
Lord have mercy,
Christ have mercy,
Christ have mercy,
Lord have mercy. For the peace from above, and for our salvation, we pray to the Lord. Lord have mercy,
Lord have mercy,
Christ have mercy,
Christ have mercy,
Lord have mercy. For the peace of the world, the well-being of God's church, and for our unity, we pray to the Lord. Lord have mercy,
Lord have mercy,
Christ have mercy,
Christ have mercy,
Lord have mercy. For this house of God, and all who worship, and all who praise, we pray to the Lord. Lord have mercy,
Lord have mercy,
Christ have mercy,
Christ have mercy,
Lord have mercy. Help us, Lord,
help us, Lord,
save us, Lord,
save us, Lord,
comfort, Lord,
comfort, Lord,
defend us, Lord,
defend us, Lord,
Lord have mercy. This is the peace, the victory for our God. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. Worthy is Christ the Lamb, who was slain, whose blood set us free to be people of God. This is the peace, the victory for our God. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.
About earthly things, but to love things heavenly. And even now, while we are placed among things that are passing away, help us to hold fast to those that shall endure. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. A reading from Jonah. When God saw what the people of Nineveh did, how they turned from their evil ways, God changed his mind about the calamity that he had said he would bring upon them, and he did not do it. But this was very displeasing to Jonah, and he became angry. He prayed to the Lord and said, "O Lord, is not this what I said while I was still in my own country? That is why I fled to Tarshish at the beginning, for I knew that you are a gracious God and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love, and ready to relent from punishing. And now, O Lord, please take my life from me, for it is better for me to die than to live." And the Lord said, "Is it right for you to be angry?" Then Jonah went out of the city and sat down east of the city and made a booth for himself there. He sat under it in the shade, waiting to see what would become of the city. The Lord God appointed a bush and made it come up over Jonah to give shade over his head and to save him from his discomfort. So Jonah was very happy about the bush. But when dawn came up the next day, God appointed a worm that attacked the bush so that it withered. When the sun rose, God prepared a sultry east wind, and the sun beat down on the head of Jonah so that he was faint and asked that he might die. He said, "It is better for me to die than to live." But God said to Jonah, "Is it right for you to be angry about the bush?" And he said, "Yes, angry enough to die." Then the Lord said, "You are concerned about the bush for which you did not labor and which you did not grow. It came into being in a night and perished in a night. And should I not be concerned about Nineveh, that great city, in which there are more than 120,000 persons who do not know their right hand from their left, and also many animals?" The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
I will extol you, my God and King, and bless your name forever and ever. Every day I will bless you and praise your name forever and ever. Great is the Lord and greatly to be praised, and his greatness is unsearchable. One generation shall commend your works to another, and shall declare your mighty acts. On the glorious splendor of your majesty, and on your wondrous works I will meditate. They shall speak of the might of your awesome deeds, and I will declare your greatness. They shall pour forth the fame of your abundant goodness, and shall sing aloud of your righteousness. The Lord is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
A reading from Philippians. For to me, living is Christ, and dying is gain. If I am to live in the flesh, that means fruitful labor for me, and I do not know which I prefer. I am hard pressed between the two. My desire is to depart and be with Christ, for that is far better, but to remain in the flesh is more necessary for you. Since I am convinced of this, I know that I will remain and continue with all of you for your progress and joy in faith, so that I may share abundantly in your boasting in Christ Jesus when I come to you again. Only live your life in a manner worthy of the gospel of Christ, so that whether I come and see you or am absent and hear about you, I will know that you are standing firm in one spirit, striving side by side with one mind for the faith of the gospel, and are in no way intimidated by your opponents. For them, this is evidence of their destruction, but of your salvation. And this is God's doing, for he has graciously granted you the privilege not only of believing in Christ, but of suffering for him as well, since you are having the same struggle that you saw I had, and now hear that I still have.
The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 20th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus said to the disciples, "The kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire laborers for his vineyard. After agreeing with the laborers for the usual daily wage, he sent them into his vineyard. When he went out about 9 o'clock, he saw others standing idle in the marketplace, and he said to them, 'You also go into the vineyard, and I will pay you whatever is right.' So they went. When he went out again about noon and about 3 o'clock, he did the same. And about 5 o'clock, he went out and found others standing around, and he said to them, 'Why are you standing here idle all day?' They said to him, 'Because no one has hired us.' He said to them, 'You also go into the vineyard.' When evening came, the owner of the vineyard said to his manager, 'Call the laborers and give them their pay, beginning with the last and then going to the first.' When those hired about 5 o'clock came, each of them received the usual daily wage. Now when the first came, they thought they would receive more, but each of them also received the usual daily wage. And when they received it, they grumbled against the landowner, saying, 'These last worked only 1 hour, and you have made them equal to us who have borne the burden of the day and the scorching heat.' But he replied to one of them, 'Friend, I am doing you no wrong. Did you not agree with me for the usual daily wage? Take what belongs to you and go. I choose to give to this last the same as I give to you. Am I not allowed to do what I choose with what belongs to me? Or are you envious because I am generous? So the last will be first, and the first will be last." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ.
Alleluia, 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 alleluia. Praise be the Lord. Alleluia, 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 alleluia. Praise be the Lord. Praise be the Lord, alleluia. Praise be the Lord, alleluia. Praise be the Lord, alleluia. Praise be the Lord. Alleluia, 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 alleluia. Praise be the Lord. Alleluia, 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 alleluia. Praise be the Lord. Praise be the Lord, alleluia. Praise be the Lord, alleluia. Praise be the Lord, alleluia. Praise be the Lord, alleluia.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. When you see someone else doing something wrong, have you ever tried to warn them before? Have you ever said, "Hey, I can tell that this is not the right thing to do," or maybe you said it in different words that were a little more forceful, but either way, you wanted to make sure that they knew that the decision they were making was not good and it was not helpful, that they might get hurt or that they might get in trouble. You try to warn them, to alert them, and then you have this deep desire in you that when you see them do what you told them not to do, and they suffer, there's this part of us that wants to say, "I told you so."
Well, that's kind of the story of Jonah that we heard today. Jonah went to Nineveh after running away from Nineveh, after he ran away and tried to go to Tarshish, trying to get away from God, what God was calling him to do. Jonah goes back to Nineveh, and he tells them that they better get their act together or they're going to be destroyed by God. And after telling them, he has no expectation that they're actually going to listen. He kind of gives them the warning with the idea in the back of his mind of, I'm going to be able to say, I told you so. And he leaves Nineveh. And Jonah has that same feeling in his heart and mind of wanting to say, I told you so. He feels like he will be vindicated when he watches the city of Nineveh be destroyed. Except there's also a nagging feeling that he's getting that Nineveh might not be destroyed. Perhaps they would actually listen to his warning and they would do the right thing. But strangely enough, that's not always what we want. The same way that's not always what Jonah wants. It's almost as if Jonah wanted for Nineveh to be destroyed. But that's not how God responds. What God does is he does not destroy Nineveh, but he relents. And Jonah is angry. He says, God, I knew it. That's why I was just not going to listen to you. That's why I was going to go to Tarshish. Because I knew that you were God who is a gracious God and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love and ready to relent from punishing. I know how you are, God. I know the nature of your character. And so you sent me to send this warning, but you never really needed me. I didn't feel like doing this anyway. Jonah, at the very least, is bitter. And he's bitter because he wanted to say, I told you so. He wanted to see them get destroyed because they'd done wrong for far too long. And in many ways, in many respects, we can understand Jonah. We can totally understand that feeling. Because there's almost a part of you that when you tell someone don't keep doing something, or when you try to warn them and you feel like they're not listening, at a certain point you're like, fine, get hurt. Then I'll be able to say, I told you so. I know as a parent, sometimes I go through that with my children. Maybe you've had that in your life too. And so you can understand Jonah's frustration when it doesn't quite go the way he was expecting, when God actually relents, because Nineveh actually responds. And it kind of makes sense to us until we realize that far too often we are actually not Jonah in the story, but instead we are Nineveh. Because Nineveh is the one who is sinning against God. The people of Nineveh are the ones who aren't listening, who are doing the wrong thing, and whom God is calling to repentance. Because God desires that in their repentance, they would be able to receive the graciousness that he offers to them, his mercy, that he is slow to anger, abounding in steadfast love, that he's ready to relent from punishing. God wants them to receive that. And so, as he sends Jonah to proclaim in a swift way the warning, Nineveh responds. By God's grace, they are led to respond, and then God relents. And that's us too. By God's grace, we would hear the warnings of how broken we are, of the sinfulness that we carry, of the ways that we sin, and the sin that surrounds us, of all the sin that we see in the world, and we would respond. We respond in repentance, recognizing that we are complicit in the acts of sinfulness, especially the ones we see in the world, that we are sinners and we need to repent and we need forgiveness. And by God's grace, by his mercy, his slow to anger nature, and his abundance in steadfast love, he relents from punishing, and instead gives himself for forgiveness. And despite that, we can find ourselves not only being like Nineveh and needing the forgiveness that God offers, and thanks be to God, receiving that forgiveness, we can also, again, find ourselves like Jonah. Bitter. Bitter that others don't suffer when we think they deserve to suffer. Bitter that we don't get to be smug and snarky and say, I told you so. So bitter, in fact, that sometimes we even attack one another as faithful believers with that bitterness, with that snark, acting as if it is a good thing, kind of finding ourselves like Jonah. And the truth is, we often deserve a lesson from God, just like God gives to Jonah, as we heard today. Because guess who Jonah needs? Jonah needs the Lord. He needs the Lord so that he can learn that he doesn't even understand how valuable and beautiful it is that forgiveness would reign, not that punishment would come down, but that grace would abound. If Jonah could simply see how good and gracious God is, he says that he knows the character of God, and yet he argues and fights against it, not because of the character of God, but because of the character of Jonah. We get the same way. We fall into our sinful nature and we forget who God calls us to be, looking for others to feel hurt and suffering rather than desiring that we would all be uplifted by the goodness and grace of our Lord. Jonah needs the Lord. And guess who Nineveh needs? Nineveh needs the Lord. They need the Lord because when they are ready to relent, when they are there in repentance, they need the grace of God, the same grace of God that we are able to know because God came down in the person of Jesus. He died on that cross. He rose from the grave. And in that death and resurrection, he reveals grace in person. He reveals grace on earth. God willing to die for us. God willing to rise for us. God showing grace and mercy and abounding love to relent from punishing and instead to forgive us, each and every one of us, with the incredible measures of his love. Dear sisters and brothers, guess who we need? We need the Lord. We need the Lord because sometimes we are like Jonah and we need to learn and to grow and then to ask for forgiveness for our stone hearts that we often show to one another, to our neighbors in need, to all those who are hurting, even to one another as Christians. We need to be ones who recognize that when we are willing to hurt our brothers and sisters, we are truly showing the brokenness of our sinful nature. We need the Lord, the forgiveness, the gracious, merciful, slow to anger, abounding in steadfast love, ready to relent from punishing Lord. Sometimes we are like Nineveh. We see that brokenness and we are moved by the power of the Spirit gifted to us in our baptism, to repent. And in that repentance, we cry out to God, God, I'm sorry. God, forgive me, please. And God comes down in the person of Jesus, just as he did. He dies on that cross. He rises from the grave to offer us that forgiveness. The forgiveness that washed us over in our baptism. The forgiveness that we come to receive each and every time we gather in the Lord's house. To hear it proclaimed and to taste and see how good it is as we receive it in body and blood. All of those gifts given to us that we would know the great forgiveness of our Lord. We need the Lord, the gracious, merciful, slow to anger, abounding in steadfast love, and ready to relent from punishing Lord. He is who Jonah needs, that Jonah would receive forgiveness, that Jonah would learn of true grace, that Jonah, instead of being angry, snarky, mean, rude, however you would want to describe him, that Jonah instead would have a heart of forgiveness and live as God calls us to live. The Lord is who Nineveh needs to receive the promises of God, to be uplifted by the forgiveness that he offers as he relents from punishing, and to continue living as God has called them to live. that they would share in the grace and mercy, the abundant, steadfast love of God. And the Lord is who we need. Because whether we're acting like Jonah, or acting like Nineveh, or anywhere in between, we need the Lord. The Lord who dies for us, rises for us, and comes to save us. So that we would not have to say, I told you so. And we would not have to cry out, Lord, help us always because of our brokenness. But instead, we would be able to cry out that we have been helped. That the one who tells us of forgiveness, of grace and mercy and abundant love. That we would know the Lord and share him with the world who needs the Lord. Together, we give thanks to God and we pray for that grace and mercy, for the God who is slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love, for our Lord who is ready to relent from punishing. We pray for his forgiveness as he gifts it to us and as we are moved to share it with the world. We do this, all of it, moved by God and motivated by grace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
If I rise, let me rise on you. Not on all of my successes, my esteem or my pursuits. If I lose, let me lose my life. 'Cause if I belong to Jesus, the flesh is crucified. For me to live is Christ, for me to live is Christ. For me to live is Christ, to die is gain. If I grow, let me grow in you. Wilt the seeds of wanting more, ripping pride out by the roots. If I'm still, let me hear you speak. Not the tone of my transgressions, but the song of the redeemed. For me to live is Christ, for me to live is Christ. For me to live is Christ, to die is gain. For me to live is Christ, for me to live is Christ. For me to live is Christ, to die is gain. My great desire is to be with you, but this is the place you chose for me. This is the place you chose for me, to lift my cross, give everything. This is the time you gave to me. This is the time you gave to me. For me to live is Christ. For me to live is Christ, to die is gain. I'll never be the same, I'll never be the same. For me to live is Christ, to die is gain. Thank you.
Together, let us confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Each petition of the prayers ends with the words, "Let us pray to the Lord," and the response is, "Lord, have mercy." Together with thankful hearts, let us breathe deeply as we focus on the words spoken, lifted by the Holy Spirit through Jesus unto our Heavenly Father. Together, let us pray. That we may seek the Lord while he may be found, call upon him in the day of salvation, and be prepared by his mercy for the day of judgment, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. That we may delight in the light of Christ and his salvation, and that sinners may find refuge in his mercy and comfort in his forgiveness, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. That the sick may be healed, the troubled know peace, the grieving be comforted, and the dying be delivered to everlasting life in Christ, and especially for the needs of all those we name in our hearts and aloud. That we may all be delivered from fear, anxiety, and despair by God's gracious care, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. That the Word of God may be the foundation of the home, and that families may be united in faith and hope, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. That the Church may nurture the lives of each and every person, recognizing that far too many lives have been marginalized and trampled down by injustice and hatred, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. That we may not forget the witness of all the faithful who lived and died in Christ, and that we may be at last joined with them in the marriage supper of the Lamb in his kingdom without end, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For these and all things, O Father, we give thanks unto you, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who has taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Together, we pray the morning prayer. I thank you, my Heavenly Father, through Jesus Christ, your dear Son, that you have kept me this night from all harm and danger. And I pray that you would keep me this day also from sin and every evil, that all my doings and life may please you. For into your hands I commend myself, my body and soul and all things. Let your holy angel be with me, that the evil foe may have no power over me. Amen.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise
Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit bless you now and forever. Amen. Together, we sing our closing hymn.
Jesus, you are.
So thankful to be with you this morning, especially in this way. Of course, we hope that you will soon join us back at Trinity in person for our in-person indoor worship at 11 a.m. We are keeping safe with all COVID-19 protocols in place, and so we welcome you back that we would have a joyful time of worship together. Of course, however you are worshiping, we want you to know this. Jesus loves you, and so do I.
Go in peace and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.